He has a varied resume. He's worked in broadcasting. He's worked in healthcare. He's been a chaplain. For more than 20 years, he's been a local church pastor. And recently, he wrote a book that once I picked up, I just couldn't put down. His name is Pastor John Baker. I'm John Bradshaw, and this is our conversation. John Baker, thanks so much for joining me.
Good to be here.
Now, we're going to cover a lot of things, including a book you wrote. And here it is. As for me and my outhouse, we will serve the Lord. Now, before we get to the title, some people are going to wonder about a title like that. Why in the world did you call a book, As for me and my outhouse, we will serve the Lord?
My wife and I had been called into the ministry 5 times and I kept saying no. Finally, when I did say yes, we moved to Appalachia, and it was there that we said, okay, now that we're doing God's will, we're going to be blessed. And we bought a house after much looking and found out that we ended up being defrauded almost the full value of the house. And in fact, the house didn't have a septic tank, and so the county was going to make us leave the house until we could provide something. And so we got a professional construction site bathroom and used it for 5.5 years, thereby getting the title for my book.
As for me and my outhouse, so you had an outhouse that you used for 5.5 years. All right, today you're a pastor, man of God, leading churches. You've done that for decades now. Let's back up. We'll go back to kind of near the beginning. Where did you spring from? Where did you begin?
I grew up in New England. My dad was a pastor, and all my life, even at the earliest age of 7 years of age, my dad was a school teacher at the time. And I just said to both my mom and dad, I want to be a pastor. And I don't think the Lord forgot that, even though as I went and progressed to get into college, I always felt that nagging thing that I was going to become a pastor, but I wanted to kind of work around the edges. So I double majored in communications and pastoring.
Okay. Well, where did that take you in the short term?
Well, I worked in broadcasting in a number of radio stations. I was a news director of several stations in Texas and went to Vermont, et cetera. But it's in small market radio, it's like crime. It doesn't pay.
Yep.
And so I had to progress and went back to school and got food management and ended up becoming a food service director of nursing homes and then a hospital. And that's when I ended up also doing chaplaincy work.
Okay. So when the opportunity came to chaplaincy work, was that a natural, or was that a what in the world? Or was it, hey, maybe this is coming back around to that prayer I prayed as a little boy?
You know, it was just so natural. I loved it. It was like being a camp counselor. Every day you get a new set of campers. And I really enjoyed that. And so that kind of got me thinking about maybe becoming a pastor later on. But I didn't do that. I went immediately into healthcare management and did that for a good 4 or 5 years before then the call to ministry came.
And how did that call come?
Yeah, they were looking for somebody to go to Eastern Kentucky, where we had served for 5 years at a little Appalachian hospital, and our name came up. And each time my name came up, the president that was looking for a pastor, we didn't look like quite the fit, and our name would come up before the nominating committee 3, 4, and 5 times. And each time he'd say, no, we're going to get somebody else. And then our name would come up. And finally, on the 5th time, he goes, I don't know who this guy is, but I have to meet him. And so he, when I was working in a healthcare assignment in Daytona Beach, I get a call at 10:20 at night asking me if I would like to interview for a pastor's job in Eastern Kentucky. And I'd been praying about it because healthcare had been so topsy-turvy that I had lost my job or had to be, you know, reassigned or what have you. And so we were open to anything. And that's what our prayer had been. And so the next day he flew down to Daytona and met with us. And of course, the rest is history.
So how soon did you know? You met him and you said, this is the thing, this is what I'm going to do? Or did it take a while to shake out?
No, you know, what was interesting was that, you know, he asked us if we wanted to become a pastor. And I said, well, whatever the Lord wants. But I was working in healthcare and had finally landed with a really secure company. The others, four of the five companies I work for, either had sold or had gone bankrupt. And so this fifth company, things were going extremely great. And I said, Lord, if you want us to be in the ministry, you have to make it very clear. Well, the next day, I got a phone call from corporate saying, everybody in Florida, all the nursing homes that we own, has to be on a mandatory phone call. And at 10 o'clock, we found out that all 54 nursing homes in this chain were being sold immediately.
Oh.
And so I said, Lord, you know, I asked you to make it known to me, and you pretty much made it clear that I didn't want to have to go through another, you know, new company and lose my benefits and do the whole thing over again. And so that was our cue that it was time to move into ministry.
So it wasn't just a move to ministry, but it was a move to Eastern Kentucky, which in some parts of ministerial circles is referred to as the Far Eastern Division. It's a fascinating place, salt of the earth people, but it's kind of a different world. So how did that manifest itself? Or did it feel like a culture shock or a real big change, or did you just ease in with no trouble at all?
Well, this is where God is amazing, because we had come from Vermont, originally at the beginning, when I was working as a food manager of a healthcare facility, to Kentucky to work as a food service director of this hospital. And so we spent 5 years in Eastern Kentucky and then went off for 4 years, only to then return. And I think it was God's way of kind of prepping us.
Sure.
Because if you've moved from Daytona Beach to Hippo, Kentucky, which is the name of our town, you have shock. In, like, you know, you have to drive 120 miles to an Olive Garden. Those were things that were really hard to get used to. And so I think God was just kind of prepping us all along the way to come back to Eastern Kentucky.
Yeah. So I want to talk to you about the house soon, but first let me ask you about this. So you dived into ministry, mm-hmm. having had some experience with chaplaincy work and mm-hmm. so forth, and you're a people person, you work with people and in people-oriented services. How was that transition into pastoral ministry? How did you find that?
To be honest with you, if anybody's ever worked in healthcare is, to me, the only business in the world where they want you to make omelets without breaking eggs. I mean, they were always asking you to do the impossible. And so I dealt with conflict. I dealt with state surveyors. I dealt with, you know, all these various things. So by transitioning into the ministry, in reality, there wasn't much that they could throw at me that I hadn't seen before. And so I praise the Lord for that, because when we moved to Eastern Kentucky, there was, as you'll see in my book, there was so many different things that required me to draw on experiences that I had. Otherwise, I wouldn't have known how to do it.
Yeah. I read this book with fascination and interest and got a lot of laughs, and I learned some things. Now, in the interest of full disclosure, we go back a lot of years. We had pastored in the same area, mm-hmm. general geographical locations. Well, we've known each other for years and years. I'm blessed to be able to call you a friend. And now my friend is an author of a book like this. And, you know, along the way, I'd heard about the house. I'd heard about the experiences you had. I'd heard, but only a little. Mm-hmm. And in here, man, you could have written another book talking about the same thing. So let's talk about the house. What happened?
Well, when we arrived, we were looking for a house. And one of the things that we recognized back there is there was a lot of problems with individuals who will take your pay but not do the job. Mm-hmm. And so our point was, if we're going to find a house, we want to make sure that we do our due diligence and have it, you know, surveyed and checked and inspected, etc. One of the funny things was that our real estate broker wanted us to buy this one house, and she says, oh, it's across the street from a floodplain. And I went, nope. And she says, what do you mean? I says, my luck in the past years, that's going to be flooded. She says, it's never in 100 years been flooded before. And I said, I'm sorry, I know differently. And so we said,
yeah.
No.
Yeah, amen.
So then we took this house. Well, either or would have caused us great pain, because 2 years after the fact, that original house that had never seen water before was swept away in a massive 100-year flood.
Oh, wow.
So even though we had the issues involving the present house that we had purchased, it just challenged us, because we had a very large district. We were traveling 5,000-6,000 miles a month. And so with all the challenges there, and then to have the challenges with the house, really, really, you know. One thing about it, though, is I remember my mom and dad came to visit, and they see the outhouse sitting outside our door. And my mother says, what's this? And I says, this is our bathroom. And they only stayed 24 hours. And my wife, tongue in cheek, said, you know, if I'd known it was this easy, I would have bought one of these things 17 years ago. So anyway, there were some things that really, as you know, in the book, a lot of things happened to us, like fire and mudslide and everything else that, but God, through every step of the way, not only provided for us, but gave us things to smile and laugh about.
That's right. Now, I don't want to tell the entire story of the book, because it's a great book, and it's one of those books I picked up and really just didn't want to put it down. I wanted to see what was going to happen next. It's really well written. I don't want to call it a real page turner, because that just sounds cliched, but it really is. And I read it through in no time at all. But let's talk about what's in the book. So you move there, and this is the crux of the thing. There's far more to it than the story of the house. I'd like to talk about one or two of those things too before we're done. But you bought a house, and then you discovered that not everything was as it had been represented.
Right.
What was first? Because as I read this, I think, oh, wow, that's terrible. Can't get any worse. And then it does. And you think, oh, it can't get any worse. And then it does. And it just about broke you financially, probably emotionally. So where did it start with the house? I mean, you buy a house, what can possibly go wrong?
Well, within 6 months of buying it, the main water line underneath our hill blew. Come to find out they used inferior pipe, and so that had to be all redone. Then we started blowing pipes underneath the house like aneurysms. We'd have people over to the house, and we're sitting in the dining room, and we hear these huge bangs. It was like somebody taking a chair and hit the floor really hard. Turns out it was floor joists that were fracturing because of the weight of the people in the room. And so as we were going through this long, we had to sue the federal government on this house because of the person that had owned it prior.
And just a minute.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Floor joists were blowing out.
Yeah.
I've never heard of that.
Well, within a month of moving into the house, we found the electric bill was super high and what have you. So I got my flashlight and I crawled under the house and I found all these fractured floor joists. I found inferior insulation. I found wiring that didn't meet code. And it was very perplexing being only there a month to find this, and yet nobody was willing to help. I mean, we searched 42 law firms or attorneys to represent us on this case, and nobody would help us because there's no money in it.
That's the reason, because there's no, well, yeah. you would have paid them, right?
Yeah.
So there's money in it.
Well, that's the reason why we had to use the outhouse, because all the money we could save, we were using to give a lump sum to an attorney.
Hey, so the floor joists were blowing out. And you mentioned that the wiring was inappropriate, inefficient. Mm-hmm. I mean, what had gone on?
Well, what was interesting is, and I had samples of it. The gentleman that owned it prior to me considered himself a carpenter, but he didn't know how to solder, and so he would use radiator hose and then screw clamps to hold pipes together, and he would use plastic pipe that wasn't meant for water to, and you go into the house and you'd find these things look like aneurysms. They were ready to explode. And so one day when we finally called this plumbing company, said, hey, could you come and look at this and see what's going on? Because we were forever trying to replace things. And that's where in the book, he comes out and he says, Pastor, it's the worst I've ever seen. We can fix this for $1,000. I said, what are you going to do? And he goes, burn it. And I laughed and I went, oh, you're kidding, right? He goes, no, it's the worst we've ever seen, $1,000, And I went, oh, no, we can't do that. So I went to a friend of mine in the community who was a retired police officer. And I says, Jeff, you're not going to believe this. But I said, they offered me $1,000 to burn my house. Well, he responds, that's terrible. Me thinking that he thought that their offer was unscrupulous.
Yeah.
He goes, oh, no, that's way overpriced. $500 is more within line. And so I'm like, oh, okay. So it was a unique area in that everybody that we had paid to inspect it just took the money and ran. Didn't do anything.
Yeah, I'm wondering about that. I'm wondering, how come you didn't find out about this before you went in? But you'd pay to have inspections done.
Well, I paid to have inspections, and that area is known for its copperheads and rattlesnakes and what have you. So, you know, when they were later on telling me, well, how come you didn't crawl under the house and check it yourself? I said, well, that's why I pay people. I'm a big guy. I'm not going to get under a crawl space and then come face to face with a copperhead or what have you. That's the reason why I pay people. And so that did come up, and I think that gave justification to the judge of my sincerity.
But you had paid people, and they simply hadn't done it.
Correct.
You ordinarily expect people to do it. Did you figure out why the power bill was so extremely high?
Yeah, it's because the insulation was inappropriate. Another thing, too, we found out after we had paid really good electricians to come in and rewire the whole house, they found pockets of junction boxes up above that had caught fire. They were charred, and that we didn't know, but God kept it only to that junction box. And there was several around that had happened. I mean, there were so many opportunities. I remember one day my daughter went to plug in something in the wall, and all of a sudden a flame that long came out and charred the wall.
Yeah, that'll happen.
So I mean, we found, I mean, that book doesn't even cover the things that we found in that house.
Pastoring is a complicated animal. I mean, And it's wonderful. It's a fantastic work. But it calls on you. It makes great demands on you. It's a draining sort of a work. That's why pastors need to be connected to God so he can continue to fill you up. So you've got a very important, very taxing job filled with life and death, eternal life and death responsibilities. And this, how do you make room in your life? You had how many churches at the time?
Three, and then I was overseeing a fourth one later on.
Okay, and you put it on 6,000 miles a month. Mm-hmm. How in the world do you make, how is there room in your life for a distraction this big?
You know, there was many things that we just prayed and said, Lord, this is your place. I mean, we would go and come back and find things that had happened. But, you know, what really brought us comfort is we recognized there's nothing in our life that wasn't given to us by God. Everything in our possession is his. All we're doing is the caretaker.
It's true.
So when we recognized that the house belonged to him, that the cars belonged to him, that everything else, it just gave us comfort. I mean, you know, in the course of doing that, we lived in such a rural area that four times in 5 years, we hit deer and totaled our cars twice. So, I mean, there was always something going on. But you know something? God gave us a sense of humor to go through that because, you know, and this is what I want people to understand. Just because bad things happen to you a lot doesn't mean you're doing anything wrong. What it means is that God is using you to witness to somebody because somebody is always watching you.
Yeah. There's a fascinating story in here, and this is the book, As For Me and My Outhouse, We Will Serve the Lord. The title is funny. Don't think it's irreverent. It's a play on fact. There's a story in here. Early in the book, you go to a restaurant. You're waiting to be seated. And the people out front, the waitstaff, whoever they were, just looked right through you and called other people and seated other people. And you're standing thinking, what in the world? Do I offend them? Do they not want my money? What in the world? And so you decided, well, they're not going to serve me. I'll go to the restaurant down the street. And you did. And that's where God brought you into somebody's life. And it was a real significant ministry situation. So you could have looked at that. It was an insult, or was it? Maybe their eyes were simply blinded. It was something negative, but you rolled with it and God brought something positive out of it. You've seen God do that again and again.
Well, and this was just prior to becoming a pastor. I had just lost my job as a healthcare administrator and I had to go back to where we had bought our car and have it worked on or what have you. And that restaurant brought an amazing thing where they actually didn't see me. I became invisible and ended up witnessing with these three young women and gave this woman hope that she did not have in the middle of her own trials.
Important, isn't it, that when things don't go the way we think they should, maybe that's because God is in it and he's leading us on to another place, another opportunity. There's plenty more to talk about, and I'm glad you've joined us for this because this is turning into a compelling conversation. With Pastor John Baker, I'm John Bradshaw. We'll be back with more of this conversation in a moment.
Hello, I'm Dr. David DeRose, a specialist in internal medicine and preventive medicine. And I've been surprised over the years in working with patients and studying the medical research literature just how powerful hemorheology is when it comes to health. You may be wondering, what is hemorheology? Well, I call it the Methuselah Factor, and that's the title of my book. The Methuselah Factor really helps you connect with things that can help your blood be more fluid. You say, why is that important? It's important because it can help you decrease your risk of a stroke or a heart attack, even lower your risk of cancer. But it's a whole lot more than just preventing killer diseases. If you improve your blood fluidity, your mind will work better, you'll perform physically better, and you'll decrease your risk of dementia. So don't hesitate. Dive into the Methuselah Factor. Make a difference in your life and the life of those that you love.
Welcome back to Conversations, brought to you by It Is Written. I'm John Bradshaw. With me, my guest, Pastor John Baker. He is the author of this book, As For Me and My Outhouse, We Will Serve the Lord. It is a wonderful tale of God's intervention, God's grace, God's providence. It's fun. You'll enjoy it. You'll smile, and you'll see the evidence of God's great work. It's available, by the way, at all the places you would expect it to be available, Amazon, Barnes & Nobles, and so forth. As for me and my outhouse, we will serve the Lord. So let's talk about the outhouse. You had that because the septic situation wasn't good.
Correct.
It's not that it wasn't good. It was a complete disaster.
Right.
You must have been astonished. So explain that situation for us.
Well, you know, after we ended up getting that, you know, one of the things that as I expressed earlier, was the fact that people are watching you.
Yeah.
And as the story began to unfold, because of the interaction we were having with people in the community, it gave me opportunities to preach at a lot of different churches. You know, Methodist, Baptist, you name it, we went all over that area. And as they would hear the story, they would go, oh, you must be Job. And I would laugh and I'd say, no, you don't understand, because at the end of Job's trials, God gave them 10 more children and my wife would kill me. So anyway, but like I said, it ended up that we ended up witnessing to the gentleman who came and cleaned it every week. We ended up talking with a whole host of people. But to use one for over five years, yeah, that was a bit of a
struggle. So what was the situation with the septic?
There wasn't any.
No, but there were toilets in there that flushed.
Well, that's true, but there was no tank in the ground. What he was doing was, something that's happened in Eastern Kentucky that people aren't aware about. It's an environmental hazard that there's probably 11,000 homes in Eastern Kentucky that call straight piping. They have no septic tank. They just run it into a local river or stream. And so that's what this gentleman was doing.
How did you discover that that's what was happening?
Well, one day we had a torrential rains and there was a steel lid that collapsed in my yard. And I thought it was the septic tank itself. Well, it wasn't. All the guy had done was dug a hole, brought in the pipe here, had a landscape pipe coming out at the top. And then every time we'd flush the toilets, it would run out and into a stream down below. So there was no septic tank at all.
And you did not know that?
Didn't know it.
There was no septic tank?
No, they'd done the test. They said, you know, they came back, the perk test worked, everything was fine. That's just one of the many problems.
Yeah, that would be more problem than just that.
Well,
one.
People didn't want to stay with us, let's put it that way. And so that did have one benefit.
Yeah, there
anyway.
You go. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you found out about that the hard way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you wrestled with that and you spoke with your wife and you said, How did you navigate that? What was your plan?
Well, there were times that, as you would think, we would get depressed and what have you. And, you know, through the time, we witnessed with our attorney. And the attorney would see us coming in and would be laughing and what have you. And he would say, how do you guys stay so happily married? He'd been married 3 times and he's like, you guys just always seem to just, you know, be so lovey and what have you. And I says, well, we'll never divorce. And he says, well, how can you be sure? And I says, 'cause no one wants the house. And so he would laugh. But as I said, it gave us opportunities to share. And in so doing, it encouraged other people. You know,
yeah.
I had talked to you earlier about, you know, anointed detours where God places things in your life or what have you that seems to be roadblocks. And in reality, it may be beneficial to you, it may be for somebody else, but either way, we are being used to present a side of the Lord that will encourage people.
Yeah, a lot of people would get into a situation like this and say, God, you've abandoned me. You didn't have that attitude even for a moment.
Heavens no.
Now, why was it so easy for you not to go to that place?
As I said, I'd been in healthcare. we had moved like I said, four or five of the companies I worked for had gone bankrupt or sold in the course of 2 or 3 years. We'd moved cross country back and forth umpteen times. We had been through the ringer. And so this was just another day doing business. I mean, I don't know what else to say. Now, the problem was it didn't just end with a septic tank. It went on. We had a fire. Somebody had driven by the house and thrown out a cigarette.
That's what caused the fire.
Correct. And I was down in Florida with a family member that was seriously ill. My wife was stayed behind. She smelled smoke, and then she saw the back part of our huge garage on fire. Opened the door, everything's in flames. So the fire had gone up and around. It consumed our barn, garage, all the hill, because we had like 6.5 acres of a mountainside. And then it came back down around, and it would have caught the house on fire. She was outside with her little garden hose trying to keep the house from catching on fire, because it took the volunteer fire department a good 20-25 minutes to get there. Mm. The struggle, and this is where we learned this, and actually this encouraged us. The fire chief couldn't believe that the boundary of the fire only affected our property. It went, the boundary of our house and it went up half up the mountain, stopped at where somebody else's property was, went all the way across, and then came back down. Only our property was the one that burned.
That would be enough to make you think you're being singled out.
Well, but actually it made us laugh, because we knew this was the devil. He's trying to discourage us,
yeah. And
we didn't want to be discouraged. So when you have that kind of epiphany, it actually encourages you.
Yeah, it's really interesting that you're able to see this for what it was.
Yeah.
A lot of people have hardship in their life and they see it for what it isn't. Some personal attack, God hates me, God's against me. Instead of understanding, we're caught in a battle between good and evil, and sometimes these negative things happen simply because there is someone out to get you. That's the devil, and he wants you to relinquish your faith in God.
Well, and you know, there were times that we would say, Lord, and there was difficult times. I mean, we would say, Lord, can you let us catch our breath? Because, you know, when the fire occurred and the power lines fell off our garage and landed in water, it short circuited stuff. So inside our house, it was a maze of wires. You know, we would have a plug work here and a plug not work there, and the refrigerator would be plugged in the hallway, and it was just kind of crazy. And we were asked to go for a job interview on the West Coast. My wife's like, well, how can we leave with this situation? And I said, well, you know, it's God's situation. What can we do? So we left. Well, what we didn't know is the 4 days we were gone, we're on the way to the airport, and I get a call from my neighbor going, have you seen your house? Like, no, why? What happened? Well, we've had torrential rains here, and because there was no vegetation on the hillside to hold back any of the water, there was a huge mudslide, and it blew out this embankment in front of our house, and our house came within probably 10 feet of sliding down and landing on top of the road down below us. So we were like, we couldn't live in our house. I couldn't even, in fact, when we arrived back home, I had to crawl on my hands and knees up this steep hill around this huge mass of mud just to get our few supplies out so we could have some clothes to live. And we ended up living in a hotel for almost a month until we could get somebody to fix that.
Did you ever think of calling that plumber back and counter-offering and saying, I hear 500
you know,
is a more appropriate?
The funny thing about it is, and this is where we got our sense of humor from, it's a miracle how it all happened, but the insurance wouldn't pay because we didn't have flood insurance. But why do you want flood insurance when you live halfway up a mountain?
Oh, yeah.
So FEMA came along and said, well, we can't do anything because your house hasn't slid down the embankment yet. And so, you know, the only money we can give you is to stay in a hotel. And so while staying at that hotel, we met a housekeeper who told us, you know, the Division of Mines might have a reason for this, because there was strip mines all around here, and that could have caused the runoff, which caused your problem. Well, that's exactly what happened. God had them come. They did a survey of the property and found out a former strip mine had caused the runoff. And the day they were there to look at it, we had torrential rains. It was taking out part of my driveway and everything. So they saw it firsthand. And it was just phenomenal. What made us laugh was that when they had the project to repair this whole thing, they put up a huge sign in my yard. Now, mind you, you probably one day, because of your fame, you might have a building named after you. Who knows? I had a natural disaster named after me because they had a huge billboard that said John Baker Mudslide. And so it was like, all right, I'll be known for disaster.
Yeah. How about that? Hey, so it worked out. Did it work out in the end? Not that I want to give the entire game away, because I want to encourage people to get the book. You can get it from Amazon, you mentioned, you get it from Barnes & Noble, yeah. Target, certain bookstores here and there. When you look back on it, did it work out badly? Did it work out well?
We were forced into negotiation by the federal government. They wore us out after seven and a half years, to settle with for about 60 cents on the dollar. And I had friends, my employer sent volunteers to help us, you know, fix everything and everything. And so we were grateful because our prayer had been, Lord, after everything we've been through, if this house can be restored, that's our cue that we can move to our next assignment. Thinking, you know, and this is where you have the idea that if I do everything God wants, then everything's going to be great. And I just want people to know that's not true. There may be lessons still to be learned. Because we had, got the house totally restored. The first person that came to look at it said, oh, we love this. We're going to pay full price. Their financing fell through, and we had not one person come and look at it from then on. It was a small community. It was known as the troubled house.
Yeah.
And so, sadly, after a year, it was foreclosed on, or 2 years, it foreclosed on us because we just couldn't afford two house payments at the same time. So we lost it.
Is it still standing today?
It is. And yet what's interesting is they only had one family live in it for about a year and a half, the first year and a half. It's been empty for the last 8 years.
Oh, really?
Really.
Huh. You've confronted this with this irrepressible sunniness, this relentless good humor. And you're a funny guy. You've got a great sense of humor. When I say funny guy, you know what I mean.
Right.
Where'd the sense of humor come from? Your ability to see, and I don't mean silliness, I don't mean that.
Right.
Your ability to see a positive when there's a negative, or to see the humorous side in something. Where'd that come from?
You know, scripture tells us there's seasons. You know, there's time to laugh, time to cry, time to dance. I prefer to be in the season where you have laughter. I mean, I see myself as kind of a golden retriever type. I like to just play and have a wonderful time. There are people, though, that are always serious, that are always looking at the downside of things. My mom and dad probably were the funniest couple I think I've ever met. They just had a wonderful sense of humor. My dad was extremely engaging, and I believe that was something that he passed on to me. But humor has opened so many doors. And there are some people that will say, you know, pastors shouldn't be funny. I don't know. Look, when Peter went down under the water when he was walking towards Jesus, we've seen people thrown in a pool with their clothes on. You can't help but laugh.
That's right.
I have to assume that Jesus must have laughed at what happened. So, I mean, I know that laughter is a medicine. That's what the Bible tells us. And I prefer to pass that along as best I can.
Yeah, yeah. Ministry, you've been at it a little while now. And you must have learned some things. I want to ask this question, but I want to see if I can ask it in a way that's appropriate, not inappropriate. You're in Appalachia. It's a rare sort of a place.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably 1,500 miles, I don't know, from New York City, but it must be in another universe. What do you learn about people in Appalachia? I know that the people got Appalachian accents. If anyone thinks I'm being disparaging, I'm not. I'm trying to ask this in a very positive way. What did you learn about people or from people by being there in, it's a rarefied environment. You know, it's not Dallas, it's not Chicago, it's not New York, it ain't even Lexington. What did you learn? What did you learn about people? What did you learn from people when you were in that really interesting place?
You know, the one thing about Appalachia that breaks my heart is the fact that they have, because of maybe lack of education and socioeconomic, people have taken advantage of them horribly. They've been robbed of coal funds and natural gas funds and what have you. So they're very, very suspect of anybody new coming in. When we came in, how do you win people over?
Yeah.
The only way you can win people over is to love them and to have a sense of humor. And I believe that helped us develop the kind of relationships in the community that we needed to flourish. And you know, we, like I said, we went to all different types of churches. We went to all different types of services. And what was crazy was, I remember we went to this one church that invited us to this dinner by the river, and it was a picnic. And they handed out guitars like you and I would hand out a napkin at a picnic. And I went, oh, I'm sorry, I don't play. And they looked at me like, what? I mean, they couldn't believe it. The culture of music and what have you was just so vibrant there. I loved it because I love to sing. And so we had a group that we would laugh about. Four of us would sing, and we would call ourselves the Uncalled For, just to be funny. But it was a gospel group, and we just had so much fun sharing the gospel and singing at all different places. And so that's one thing I just really, really love about my Appalachian friends.
So even during your time, you're going through this personal crisis with this home from hell, and yet you're finding warmth and joy and fellowship and friendship in the people of the community.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, to be honest with you, people don't remember what you say to them. They only remember how you treat them.
Yeah.
And so anything that I would be going through paled in comparison. I had a buddy of mine that was a pastor there in the area. He was dying of cancer. And he would come to me going, oh, John, I feel so bad about your house and what have you. And I said, Mark, let me ask you something. It's perspective. He goes, what do you mean? I said, would you trade your problems for mine? I mean, he had five kids, you know, and he goes, oh, man, in a heartbeat. I said, that's my perspective. I'm not going to worry about what I'm dealing with because I know you have it worse.
Mm.
So I'm going to do everything I can. And that's one of the things I think it's important for people to do. You got to maintain a level of normalcy no matter what you're going through. And you got to put your eyes on Christ, but on other people. How can I help them ease their burden? There's always somebody who's got it worse than you do.
Let me ask this question. How have you kept your eyes on Christ? What have you done to keep yourself spiritually strong, spiritually well, healthy, during a time where, I mean, this was relentless attack. It was really difficult for years and years. What were you doing? Were you doing anything out of the ordinary or tailored to help yourself spiritually? What were you doing intentionally to grow in your faith in God?
Well, read voraciously. I mean, I always try to get my hands on things that would encourage me. Writing was another thing that I would do. And some of the things that I would write, other churches in my community would put in their bulletins just as an encouragement to their members.
Nice.
But I just think that it's important to stay connected by staying in the Word. You know, one of the things I do is I send out devotionals to people and share the Word of God so that people will say to me, hey, I don't understand this. What do you think? Right now, I send out over 200 every day. And I have to translate it into three languages plus English. I do it in Urdu, Russian, and Spanish.
Well, so you learned to feed on the Word and remain encouraged in the Lord even when you're going through something that was just, it was a titanic headache, wasn't it?
You know, I am so blessed that God gave me a woman that was just amazing. I don't know anybody else that could have had an outhouse for 5.5 years, that could have had a house that almost burnt down, have a house to almost go down a hill. I mean, this woman is a saint, and yeah, She'll agree.
And she probably should. Where do you think that came from? I mean, how does people divorce for far less?
Mm-hmm.
For far less. What did you guys do to keep your marriage strong in that time? Was it intentional, or my question is, or was your bond already so strong, so healthy that you guys were ready for anything?
We had a real strong bond, but you know, we have a sense of humor. I mean, truly, our love for the Lord and service, but a sense of humor is key.
Yeah, well, it's served you well so far. In a moment, we're going to talk about ministry, what you've learned along the way, some of the challenges and the blessings of a life in ministry. We'll talk a little bit more about the book as well. The book is As For Me and My Outhouse, We Will Serve the Lord. With Pastor John Baker, I'm John Bradshaw, and this is Conversations, brought to you by It Is Written. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, New York City, Marilyn Monroe, and Thailand all have one thing in common. Like Abraham and Jacob in the Bible, they all had their names changed. And God intends to give you a new name. Don't miss Your New Name, brought to you by It Is Written. Discover that God has a new name and a new experience waiting for you. Recount some of the greatest, most dramatic stories in the Bible, and you'll see that God still has big plans for His people, even when they stumble. Your New Name will take you from Genesis to Revelation as you discover the ultimate destination for those who have faith in Jesus. Don't miss Your New Name, brought to you by It Is Written TV. Welcome back to Conversations, brought to you by It Is Written. My guest is Pastor John Baker, the author of As For Me and My Outhouse, We Will Serve the Lord. It is an encouraging tale. It's a remarkable tale. Just when you think it couldn't get any more impossible, it does. And then God brought you out of this thing. So you were able to leave that situation behind when you exited and took up ministerial duties in another place. What was it like for that burden, that hassle, to just be gone? It's like being cured of something. You live with something for so long and it's gone. How'd that feel?
You know, I remember in scripture where it talks about Job, and every time you turn around, you know, they would say to him, the Amalekites have stolen your goats and the Hittites have stolen your camels. And that, you know, it was always something that was hitting you. When we got away from that, it was like a beautiful breath of fresh air. I arrived at my minister's meetings in Tennessee, West Tennessee. And I told all my friends, it's good to be here in Tennessee. And the first thing they said is, do you have any bathrooms? And I said, yes, God blessed us with three. And they go, well, great. Are they all inside? So they had a lot of fun with me on that.
Yeah, I bet they did. So ministry, I think it's a wonderful job. I don't think there's any up from there. Person who becomes a pastor, in my opinion, starts at the top. And then some people get demoted to administration and that sort of thing. What are the unique blessings in ministry for you? You've been at this a little while now. What do you consider to be 2, 3, or 4, or 5 of the great blessings of being involved in ministry?
You know, one of the things that I try to do is I try to think outside the norm. There are many pastors that come and feel like that they're only supposed to serve their church. And we come with the idea of we need to serve the community. One of the highest compliments that we were paid back in Kentucky was the fact that they said, you know, John Baker is everybody's pastor.
Nice.
When we left, we were blessed. The Catholic Church had a goodbye luncheon for us. The convent had a goodbye dinner for us, and involved us in their evening prayers and prayed for our ministry. We had developed so many friends, and we wanted to bring that to the next place we came.
Yeah.
What was crazy was we had only been to our district, our new place, for 2 days, and I was immediately put in the hospital for 4 days with a terrible infection that had gone into the lining of my stomach. And it was like, okay, can we at least have just a little moment where things get normal?
Yeah,
and so praise the Lord, He did that. But anyway, in regards to ministry, we feel if you serve the community, then it offers you opportunities to be able to share with them the uniqueness of how you believe, what you believe in God. And so we've, like I said, we've made just a lot of friends.
As you would, if someone was coming into ministry and they said to you, hey, Pastor John, what are 2 or 3 things that I need to keep in mind as I enter ministry? What would you say to a young minister?
Well, I think first off, I think you need to be patient. There are things that we really want, and God tells us sometimes you've got to wait. I think one of the most important things is don't look at yourself or look at your present situations. As long as you're serving, as long as you're loving people, the focus is not on you. Because if it is, then you get stressed, you know, and all the other things that come along with it. And so I tell people all the time, you know, one of my colleagues one time told me, he says, you know, being a pastor, it's unique. It's like they take all your blood and then complain you look pale. And so sometimes it can do that. But if you develop friendships in the community, I mean, we do things like a banquet for the community where we have, you know, 128 people, mostly non-members of our church, that just come in and find out about Christmas, and we share with them the beauty of the story of the birth of Christ, which is all something we have in common with everyone. And in that score, it has truly blessed not only the ministry, but all the friends that we make in the process.
Yeah. Now I want to ask this delicately. We talked about the blessings of ministry. If that same young minister came to you and said, I start tomorrow, what are some challenges that I might expect as a pastor? What would you say?
Well, I think one of the biggest challenges is the fact that you always have conflict. One of the things that I saw, I had a friend of mine introduce me to a ministry that deals in peacemaking. And it was something that I went to like a duck out of water. Back in Eastern Kentucky, we lived in the same district where the Hatfields and McCoys, that feud. And so there was a lot of bitterness and unforgiveness in that area. And so when I came to the understanding of how to make peace the biblical way, man, everything I could do, I would take, I would learn, I would, you know, extrapolate. And that's what I use in my ministry, because there are many times when you'll tell somebody, you know, I'm a pastor, and they immediately get nervous,
right?
You know, but if you tell them, oh, I'm a conflict coach. And I do have recognition by my denomination as a conflict coach. And so that always goes like, well, what does a conflict coach do? And I said, well, do you have conflict in your life? Well, yeah. Do you have conflict with yourself? Yeah, sometimes it's hard. You know, I can't forgive myself. I help you deal with that. And so what it does is opens up opportunities to talk, to counsel, or do whatever. And it just, it's marvelous.
Yeah. Over time in ministry, even in life, but over time, have you seen any trends in the church or in church members? Have behaviors changed? Have people become more like this or more like that? People are just people, same as they've ever been. What would you say?
Well, you know, I think what happened was it was already trending, but COVID kind of put it into fast gear, that we got so used to having it easy. People would stay home and just watch It Is Written on TV rather than go to their local church. And it you know, people aren't participating. They're not doing things in church. You know, I told someone one time, I said, you know, I'm getting up there in years. I've had major back surgery. And I said, I feel like sometimes a horse on the way to the glue factory. And yet I've also recognized that there are some people that would ride this horse all the way to the glue factory too.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you have to do is you have to kind of inspire people to see a vision beyond, you know, their local church. Because if you don't have a vision, scripture tells us where there's no vision, the people perish. You want to get your eyes off yourself. And that's the reason why in my churches, I try to get people involved in ministries that are unique. Someone might not want to sweep a floor, but they might want to serve a meal at the local soup kitchen. And so we're always trying to do things, you know, a vegetarian supper club once a month, things like that, that will engage people. And that's what we try to do.
COVID, I've had some pastors say to me, I've said, how's your churches doing? Some, not all, and some will say, our church will never recover.
Mm.
And I don't know whether that's prophetic utterance, you know, 50 years from now, 5 years from now, but they've noticed that their churches are just not the same and have not bounced back, and they are lesser than they were. How do we get beyond that, do you think? I don't even know what kind of a question that is, but is there a way forward for churches that have taken a hit? Some churches, it was conflict, others people just stayed home, some have got out of the groove. How are we going to get past that?
Well, I think one of the ways to get past that is to show people love, not tell people love, show people love. You know, people are drawn to family, to friendship circles, whatever. If you're feeling affirmed and loved and what have you, you're going to be drawn to that. Our churches need to be doing that. The sad part about it is too many of our churches just want to be inward.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And I'm like, okay, do you have some sort of a ministry? Do you have like a women's ministry? Well, we have a leader. Well, if you don't have a program, what good is a leader? It's like having a general with no army. And so I want people to get outside that comfort zone, invite somebody to dinner. My wife and I budget probably $150 to $200 a month taking young people or couples out to dinner to give them a place just to feel neutral where they can just let their hair down and talk and what have you. And it's just, it's opened up. At our church right now, we're back to our original membership, in fact, growing. Our church now is all different ethnicities, and we're loving it.
Yeah, fantastic. Isn't that fantastic? Hey, so how, where'd the idea come from for the book? I imagine people said to you, oh, you've got to write a book. Your story is just so interesting. You got to write a book. Is that what happened?
You know, I really felt like one of my buddies, he was the one who came up with the title, and I went, boy, that's really, really good. I am a storyteller, always have been. In fact, when I went to Eastern Kentucky, one of my first two sermons, I just didn't connect. And my wife says, you got to go back to the basics of how Jesus did his ministry. And we always remember his sermons, the Sermon on the Mount, all the various things that he was trying to do. So I began to tell stories, and I began to realize that when you tell stories, not only are people understanding the concepts better, but it engages them. And so that's what I've utilized in what I'm doing presently in Pakistan. I have this outreach ministry to, I met a gentleman online who liked a sermon that I did. And none of these pastors are members of my faith, but I become a mentor to like 30 pastors over in Pakistan. And so I send them my sermon notes and I do all these various things, but I train them. Nobody's talking to them about marriage because that area over there doesn't always honor the woman like they should. And so I'm beginning to show them concepts by loving them and being generous. And that's what's really inspiring me right now.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. Is there another book inside you?
I do. I'm working on actually two. I have a second one that's kind of a prequel to this.
Oh, yeah.
That has some amazing stories as you can imagine. And then another one I want to do is I've got a publisher that has expressed interest, a 365-day devotional where there's a humorous story every day. And they said, that's something that we've never seen before. And that's kind of a challenge to me. And I'd like to do that.
Mm, mm, yeah. Mm, mm, mm. So were you always a writer? You've said that you were writing in bulletins and so forth for churches and this and that.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. When I was in college, I had a college professor that said I couldn't write. And any paper I ever did for him, he gave me a D.
Oh.
And so when someone says I can't do something, it just propels me to prove them wrong. And so when I got out, I ended up working in healthcare out in New Mexico, and I went to a local newspaper and I said, hey, look, I'll run a funny column on life if you'll just advertise that I work at this nursing home. And they took it. And so for a year, I was a humorist columnist for them. And that then got me the creative juices to say, you know, if I've done that, maybe I should write a book. And so I began to do things piecemeal. And right now I have so many articles that I just haven't published that I want to incorporate in my books. And so I find that I can lose myself in it. And sometimes I like it because I can amuse myself. Sometimes something funny happens. I'm like, you know, I'd like that. I think it makes me laugh.
Yeah, absolutely. And if it moves you, it might just move somebody else as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the book, when I read it, it was, as I said earlier, one of those books you pick up and you can't put down. And congratulations on a job really, really well done. Just fantastic. So let me ask you this. As you sit down to write the prequel to the book, are you seeing, hey, there's a big long series here? Is there a Charles Dickens inside of you or a Mark Twain?
I don't know about that.
Easy does it.
Well, you know, it's tough to get the time to write.
That's right.
Because when you have a couple of churches like I do, you're on the road a lot. Yep. During the COVID season, my wife and I drove double the miles that we typically did because we knew that there were so many church members that felt, disconnected.
That's really interesting. I would say many pastors drove zero the miles.
Well, you know, one of the things I did is I kind of like to inspire some of my buddies in the community, some of the other pastors. And one of my friends said, I want to do what you do. What we would do is I would go out and buy gift cards and get, you know, Domino's or, you know, Papa John's, whatever. And then what we would do is we would deliver pizzas and then deliver the study quarterly or a sharing book. And then we would, you know, pass it around the door, have a prayer, and then hit the road. And it was nice. You could cover more territory that way.
Yeah.
And so he calls me up one day. He goes, I want to do that. And I'm like, okay, let's do it. So then 5 minutes later, he calls back. He goes, well, you know, I don't have a lot of money, right? So I'm like, okay, so look, I'll tell you what. I'll pay for the pizzas and I'll provide a sharing book. What's a sharing book? Trust me, you'll love it. So I did all these sharing books he gave to his church members as we made deliveries around the community.
Oh, yeah, fantastic.
So it was really cute. And I've made some great friends in his church. My wife and I even did a marriage enrichment thing in his church, and it was just a lot of fun.
And let me ask you this. As long as I've known you, it comes through in the book and in what you're saying here. You're a generous guy. You're also a guy who lost his shirt.
Mm-hmm.
But while you were losing your shirt, your house, you're still a generous guy. How do you do that? I mean, when there isn't much to give, most people would say, there's just not much to give. But it seems as though, and I'm not asking you to toot your own horn here, but this is just a fact of who you are. It seems that you and Leanne, your wife, never have backed off from sharing what you have, whether it's a little or a lot.
When I arrived in Tennessee, because we were doing both houses and whatever, I was having to go to a check writing place just to get the extra $200. And then as we began to do the brand of ministry that we found to be successful, taking people out to dinner, helping get things, supplies for people, etc., you're only relegated to like $200 in Tennessee. But if you wrote a check outside of Tennessee, you could go above that. And so every 2 weeks I was driving to Murray, Kentucky to write a second check. And I was paying out the ears in interest. But what was interesting was how God blessed us. We had lived in our house for 5 years. And once that loss of the house came by, the landlord said, why don't you buy my house? And I said, well, you know, give me a good deal. And he called me and I prayed about it. I said,
and this is the landlord in
that we live now in our house.
In Tennessee, not Kentucky.
And we ended up buying the house at probably almost half the going rate. And that was the blessing that God gave us. I said, Lord, if you want us to buy it, I have this much cash. And boom, and he sold it to me for half the going rate. And so God has more than blessed me for anything that I've been out financially. Now, of course, I don't have to write check places anymore, the Lord.
Yeah.
But it didn't stop our generosity because God is, you cannot give God.
Isn't that an amazing testimony? You stay true and you've as a faithful steward and you do what you can and God will be there for you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, fantastic. Very little time left. In your mind, what's the best story in this book? Most fun or most powerful, most
potent,
most meaningful?
Well, one of the most powerful ones that I had was probably in there is about one of my church members that called me wanting to take her life.
Yes.
And I ran.
Tell that story.
I drove as quick as I could to the house. And when I arrived at the house, you know, I said, I called the police. They wouldn't go in without me. So I drove as fast as I could, 35 miles to get to her house. And when I arrived and she saw that I brought a policeman with me, she got mad. And so she pulled a gun on both of us. And so then we had to back out. And then they called the rest of the guys in. It turned out to probably be the biggest story in that little town's police department. But that one kind of opened my eyes to many things. Yeah.
Including the fact that you can have a church member who calls you for help. And then she turns a gun on you.
Yeah.
Threatens to blow you away.
That was very eye-opening. One thing that I have learned is that, the police officer asked me, he says, does she have a gun? And I said, what woman in Eastern Kentucky doesn't have a gun?
Yeah,
and he goes,
go.
Okay, then we'll wait for you to get here.
Yeah. Yeah, no question.
Yeah.
And it all worked out okay in the end.
Right.
Amen. Well, hey, thank you for taking your time. Thanks for coming to chat. Here's the book again. As for me and my house, sorry, as for me and my outhouse, we will serve the Lord. I don't want you to be bothered if you think the title is offensive. It's not meant to be. It's about Pastor Baker and his outhouse, among other things. I think you'll really be encouraged. Great job on the book.
Thank you very
much.
I
enjoyed it. Like I said, I think twice already, picked it up and just didn't want to put it down at all.
I have a church in my community that gives these to people in the hospital. They say, we don't want to give flowers that die. We want to give this book. And they've bought dozens and dozens of books from me.
Fantastic.
And it's just been, it's been remarkable.
Yeah, great stuff. Look forward to whatever you do next. Thank God for you and your pastoral ministry have been a blessing to thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Now you have an outreach that reaches around the world. We wish you all the very best. Thanks for being here. God bless you.
God bless you as well.
Really appreciate it. That's my friend, Pastor John Baker, and I'm just so glad that you've been able to participate with us in this conversation. It's been a lot of fun. With Pastor John Baker, I'm John Bradshaw. This has been Conversations, brought to you by It Is Written.